Happy holidays from London. We began the year with two world number ones, Novak Djokovic and Serena Williams. And we finished the year with two new world number ones, Andy Murray and Angelique Kerber. We take a closer look at how Andy and Angie made their way to the top.
Plus, coming up on the show, my visit to Sweden for a rare interview with Bjorn Borg.
We both remember every single point.
Really?
Yes.
And it's a fairy tale come true. Juan Martin Del Potro brings the Davis Cup home to Argentina for the very first time. And it may come as a huge surprise to you, but I'm not a one-take wonder. We've got a fresh serving of open court outtakes just in time for the holidays.
We begin with the men's race for the year ending number one. Never in the history of the ATP has it come down to the final match of the season. However, it did this year when Novak Djokovic faced off against Andy Murray right here in London.
Commentator Nick Lester looks back on a season that's had its fair share of surprises.
Novak Djokovic has loved playing in Melbourne over the years. Once he was able to get by Federer, you know, he was very sharp indeed in the final. You had the two guys that dominated the year. I think it set the tone, really, didn't it, in many ways for the year with the top two guys, you know, in the final.
This serves as a great confidence booster, a great wind in the back for the rest of the season.
It was then on to the next challenge, and the one big challenge that was missing. Everything else for him was about peaking towards the French.
Thank you very much, everybody. Bye.
Very difficult conditions, very challenging conditions in Paris. The weather was dreadful. It was cold, it was wet. You got to remember, this carrot's been dangling for a long time for Djokovic. You know, for 3 or 4 years, he had three of the four. And for him to finally get it done and release that pressure was just huge.
Today, you know, I probably experienced one of the most beautiful moments in my professional tennis career.
I think people were thinking it could be four in a year here. You know, this guy at the moment is so far ahead of everyone else that we're looking possibly at doing something even a level above what he's just achieved. Andy Murray became a very warm favourite, I think, you know, playing well, having played one Queens again, coming into form, enjoying the grass, sensing his opportunity with Djokovic having gone, the field, the draw opened up for him nicely.
First time was more relief, and I wasn't as happy as I was this time. And I just wanted to make sure that this time I spent, you know, the hours afterwards and the day afterwards with my closest friends and family.
I think there was a sense that it was a blip for Djokovic, no more. He would get back on the wagon pretty quickly. A surprise to many, but not a surprise to Stan Wawrinka. You know, he's physically a beast, Wawrinka. He is as strong as they come. In many ways, took the racket out of his hand.
This is the biggest challenge you can have, playing Novak Djokovic, number one player, in the US Open final. And I have to say, I'm proud with what I've achieved.
After the US Open, I think Murray sensed his chance. I think it was one of the best atmospheres of the year, and to have two players for the final match of the year go at it for the Euro number one, is you couldn't write that script.
I never expected to have a second half of the year like I have.
I think if you'd have told someone Andy Murray would be in the year number one, they'd have probably looked at you in a very strange way and wondered what you've been taking, because it just wasn't on. It wasn't on at that time. But, you know, things change in life.
This is the time of the year where some of my former foes gather together to play champions tennis at the Royal Albert Hall.
Former world number one Patrick Rafter came to play, and we caught up on the sidelines for a chat.
What do you think about Djokovic? I mean, he's kind of done everything. Do you think Novak can get back to number one?
Is he good enough? Yes, we know he's good enough. You know, so, yeah, certainly, but you know, mentally, is he there? But he's definitely got the potential to get back to number one. Mm. And Andy Murray? Had a great year. Will he be able to solidify it? I don't know.
And Rafa, of course, he's had the injuries. Yeah. I don't know if he ever, certainly when he came on the circuit, he said, this guy's not going to last until he's 28. The intensity that he has. And he's barely got beyond that. He's still struggling with the injuries.
But we thought there for a time that he was going to take over Federer, didn't we? He got to 14 and he's hit a brick wall. So there is that time. Now I wonder with Djokovic and Murray how many more years they've got at the peak.
Young guy we're all excited about in Australia. Mm-hmm. well, there's a couple of them, Bernard Tomic and Nick Kyrgios particularly. Nick's getting a few headlines for for some of the wrong reasons, but also for some of his great play. How do you see his year coming through?
He's a real mystery to me at the moment. I don't know how he's coping with things mentally. So he's got the potential, we all know that. Probably in game-wise, Nick's probably can do it, but I don't know about physically. You know, you've got to be an all-around good athlete as well. Can he back up seven matches? Aussie Open, probably not. French Open, definitely not. US, no, but Wimbledon, he certainly can. I know as a talent-wise, I think he's as good as I've ever seen. You know, in the last 20 years, I go, wow, he could be number one in my mind. But you look at Dominic Thiem, he seems to be a great professional young kid who can get it all together.
All right, Pat, you've got to give us some predictions for next year. Who do you see coming through in the Grand Slams?
I'm going to say Djokovic have a half-decent year again and win a couple of slams. Murray still be there. And I'm going to see Del Potro pushing things around as well. Hopefully he'll have a great year. And maybe we might see the young emergence of one of the young kids, as you mentioned.
Thanks, buddy. Well, thanks very much for your time.
Cashy.
Good luck this week.
It's great to get a normal handshake.
We'll see you back home.
The Mannequin Challenge is quite popular this holiday season. Champions Tennis produced their own version, and you can watch it on our Open Court Facebook page.
For years, tennis fans have known Angelique Kerber as a good, solid player. I mean, after all, she had been in the top 10 for almost 5 years. She's known for her baseline play and her competitive streak. Well, we followed her progress throughout the year and watched her turn from good to great.
Melbourne, Australia. This is where it all started in January of 2016. Angelique Kerber travelled to the season's first Grand Slam as the world number 10. The 28-year-old had only made one Grand Slam quarterfinal in the past 3 years. Her team had high hopes, but no one was picking her to win it all. Against the odds, she defeated world number 1 Serena Williams in the Australian Open final. This was the German's first ever Grand Slam win.
Always my goal to win the Grand Slam, and last night my dream came true.
Back home in Germany, Kerber became a sporting hero overnight. A sellout crowd at the Fed Cup tie in Leipzig gave Kerber a hero's welcome home. She was Germany's first Grand Slam champion since Steffi Graf in 1999.
We had 10 years when tennis was nothing in Germany, and now we have this, and I hope it goes on in this direction.
After her Grand Slam win, Kerber suffered 5 first round losses in the next 5 months, including the French Open. It was another surprise champion who took the spotlight in Paris. Spain's Garbiñe Muguruza beat Serena Williams to win her first Grand Slam title. Meanwhile, Angelique Kerber's plan was to hit back at Wimbledon and prove she wasn't a one-slam wonder. She made her second Grand Slam final, but this time around, Serena Williams proved too strong. With the win, the American superstar tied Steffi Graf's record of 22 Grand Slam singles titles. After the loss at Wimbledon, Kerber returned to the gym to train and focus on how to beat Serena Williams the next time around. She gave Open Court exclusive access to one of her training sessions.
Of course, I mean, Serena is a powerful, strong player, and she is serving like 200 kilometers per hour, or like hitting the ball so fast. So that's why you must be really fit and trying to move in good to get all the balls she is like hitting.
The hard work paid off as Kerber won the silver medal at the Rio Olympics. The tennis world quickly shifted from the Olympics to the US Open. All eyes were on the new state-of-the-art roof. And the media was fully focused on Serena's bid to break Graf's record. But for the second year in a row, the slam didn't go Serena's way. She lost in the semi-finals.
I wasn't able to move the way I wanted to move, or, you know, when you're injured, you're thinking of other things when you should be just playing and thinking of your shots, and my mind was just a little bit everywhere, but it was what it was.
Angelique Kerber seized the opportunity and powered through to win her second Grand Slam title.
Well, this is nice.
It is.
Yes.
Very special text message before the finals. Who was that from?
From Steffi Graf. I mean, she wrote me, yes.
Was she a big influence on
your
life?
Yes, she is really the biggest idol of my life.
With her victory in New York, Kerber became the new world number one, replacing Serena Williams. The day after her big win, I met up with her for a coffee in Central Park.
Now your life must be kind of crazy. You've got to be doing press conferences everywhere you go, no?
Yeah.
Every tournament.
Yeah, it's changed. I mean, I have so much things to do off court right now.
The numbers of Kerber's surprise breakout season tell the story. Two slams, three Grand Slam finals, Olympic silver, world number one. And $10 million prize money this year alone, which is more than she had made during her entire career. But where does she go from here? Can she hold on to the number one ranking? Coach Torben Belts believes that Angie can still improve.
And already now, we're thinking about some stuff because she's number one, but we're still thinking about new stuff to do, and it's not the end of the road now. We really want to go forward now and get the next step to stay there and to play better tennis.
Of course, it will be a new situation for me. Nobody has nothing to lose right now against me, and for sure, I mean, the pressure will be still a little bit higher than it was before.
We're looking back on a tennis year to remember. To read more about the highs and lows, log on to our website, cnn.com/opencourt. We'll be right back with one of our biggest interviews of the year.
This year, Bjorn Borg invited me to Stockholm for a catch-up, a chance to talk about the good old days, but also to hear how the legend is enjoying himself as a tennis dad.
I'm okay.
Good seeing you.
Everything's good. Yeah, mate. Good. Thanks for coming.
So Bjorn, you're a tennis dad now. I don't see you as a typical tennis parent. Are you screaming at the back? Move your feet. I can't imagine Bjorn Borg doing that.
No, I'm not doing that. No. But I'm a tennis dad, and we have a son, Leo. He just turned 13 years old, and he's playing 2-3 hours every single day after school, but he's completely nuts about tennis. He has a big heart for tennis. He likes to play, he likes to compete, he likes to travel. You know, I like to stay home. You know, I'm getting a little bit older. We've been traveling all over the world, not only one time, but 100 times. But that's me as a person.
Bjorn lives outside of Stockholm and drives his son to school every day. He still regularly plays tennis and is actively involved in the clothing line that bears his name.
To the Bjorn Borg office, I probably go maybe 3 times a week because I'm very interested to see what they do with the design and trying the clothing, if it fits good regarding, you know, how it's going to work on the tennis court.
Borg was the first player in history to win 5 Wimbledon singles titles in a row. He had many memorable moments at the All England Club, but there's one match in particular that many have found hard to forget. The 1980 Wimbledon final against John McEnroe.
15-14.
Do you look back at those memories fondly?
I think a lot of people around the world appreciate that final, and they say they knew exactly where they were sitting watching the final. Mm. But even when I speak to John too, sometimes we get together, and the thing is that we both remember every single point.
Really?
Yes. Okay. I think that's how it meant a lot for both of us. I mean, for me, I came out as a winner. I mean, even if he lost that match, but like he said, for so many years, and I think the same, I think he got a lot of respect from the world, from the people, from spectators, from media, from everyone, how he behaved, and how he played that particular match.
Look at this guy.
Our morning spent reminiscing about our favourite Wimbledon memories was drawing to a close, but I couldn't let Bjorn go without wishing him a happy birthday.
When I came 60 years old, can imagine, it's a big number anyway, but we're not going to have a big party, just with 500 people. No, I'm just joking.
Wants to forget 60s, now starting to forget them.
It's going to be a family thing.
Well, we're happy you made it, put it that way.
Thank you. Thanks.
It's always great catching up with one of my heroes, Bjorn Borg, but we're also fortunate enough to catch up with several other legends this year and to find out what's happening in their world.
I'm pretty busy with my missions of building schools across the country and a handful of other things that have been pretty, thank goodness, occupying and successful for me.
My life now, two young children, family, with my husband Andre, and running a foundation and different partnerships which got me here to Rio. It's been a busy life, but not so much on the court anymore.
You can watch the rest of this video on our Open Court website. When we come back, we take you behind the scenes here at Open Court, where not everything goes according to plan.
It's been a smashing summer of tennis. Oh, and I missed it. Welcome back to our holiday edition of Open Court. Well, I have a lot of fun hosting this show, and our team do a great job of piecing it all together, because I've been known to make the occasional blooper. Here are some of our favourite Open Court outtakes. It's been a smashing summer of tennis. Oh, and I missed it. I'd like to take this opportunity to
direct in TV.
I've been invited for a behind the scenes tour of the new roof.
Sorry.
Oh. No. Does that count?
No.
He's changing the rules.
Lucky I have here. Who's the best looking CNN host that you know?
I wonder if I can make this a fashion statement again.
Oh, sorry, battery's just gone.
Are you nervous or not?
I was nervous.
Oh man, you hit the camera guy. There's so many bit. The Philippe Chatrier court is the centerpiece of this. Thanks very much for joining us on this month's show. Next month we head to Paris. The stands were packed in 1983 as Mats Wilander and Yannick Noah entered the stadium.
That was pretty good. I don't think I'm going to get any better than that.
I think I carried away.
Baby. You still got it, baby. You still got it. Still got it. Great to see you. Thank you. Thanks.
We've made it easy for you to watch any video clip you want from the show. Log on to our Open Court Facebook page, where we're also posting photos of the players enjoying the holiday season.
The tennis year had its fair share of ups and downs, but there are a few highlights I won't soon forget.
Monica Puig's gold medal run at the Olympics was one of the biggest surprises of 2016. When the Puerto Rican entered the Rio Olympics, she was ranked in the top 35 and had not beaten a top 10 player all year. During her gold medal run, she beat three Grand Slam champions in a week, Garbiñe Muguruza, Petra Kvitova, and Angelique Kerber.
After the final, I just remember grabbing the phone and just saying, Mom, Dad, I did it, I did it, I did it. And they were crying with emotion.
Monica will go down in history as Puerto Rico's first ever gold medalist. Another show highlight of the year was Gordon Reid's gold medal win in Rio. The Scotland native closed out the year as the number one wheelchair tennis player in the world. He won the Australian Open and Wimbledon before winning at the Olympics.
You know, it's given me, you know, so many opportunities in life that I never would have had to play tennis at the highest level, the Grand Slams, and share my locker with Federer and Murray and Nadal, and travel the world when I'm still only 24, being all over the place. Probably the most tanned man in Scotland half of the year.
In September, Reid shared a special gold medal moment with fellow Scot Andy Murray in front of a sellout crowd in Glasgow. And finally, the moment that I won't soon forget. Argentina won the Davis Cup for the first time in history. Juan Martín del Potro defied the odds and led his team to victory over Croatia.
First time you've ever come back from two sets to love down to win a match. It was phenomenal.
Yeah. It's tough to me to say something, but I did my best playing with these colors, and it's amazing.
I'll let you go.
Thank you.
There was no question what this win meant to Juan Martín del Potro and his teammates. It's a safe bet that the 2016 Davis Cup champs will be celebrating their victory well into the new year.
Thanks very much for joining us on this holiday edition of Open Court. It's been great to look back at a fascinating year in tennis and have a few laughs along the way. I want to wish you and your family a wonderful and safe holiday season. Goodbye from London.
Open Court, in association with Rado.